name is Furman Fordham. I am the senior pastor of Riverside here in Nashville. And we want to welcome you to our Riverside family and to our ministry. We are so happy that you have tuned in. Our prayer is that you will come to know God, grow in God, and sow God's love. We are praying that this presentation will be a blessing to you. And if you are ever in Nashville, we invite you to come worship with us. May God bless you, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
Indeed, it is our desire to be where God is, for that's how He made us from the beginning, to be with Him. And through an unfortunate turn of events, we have been separated for some time now. But my God is a relentless pursuer of what's His. And I praise Him that He has not given up on bringing us back to where He is. For Your glory, God, we will do anything just to be where You are. I hope that is your hunger and your thirst this morning, to be where God is. Thank our praise team. I want to thank Pastor Fordham for his remarks, for his introduction. I say again and again, he is an apostle in this place. He is, if you want to be a leader, then just come under his discipleship. If you want to be a spiritual leader in the house of God, then find your way to his feet. God is leading him, and I am just praising God that he has made me a beneficiary of his ministry. You might even hear me talk like him a little bit, or you might see me sit like him, or you might see me run a meeting like him. It just kind of rubs off on you. Now, I don't know if I'm going to go as far as falling in love with the Chiefs, but I praise God for his leadership. I praise God for my girlfriend, for my wife, for my best friend in life, Miss Gabriella. It's just so good that I'm going through life with her. And I'm just glad for her. I thank you for your affirmation this morning. I appreciate that loving service here at Riverside, my home. Loving service here. Well, if you're following the news any, you know that there is a presidential race going on. And things are a little bit interesting, aren't they? I ain't gonna step too far in it. We're just gonna go a little ways. We'll go a little ways. Things are a little interesting, but I'll be honest with you. I am, I'm a little weary of the trumpet blasting in my ears. If you're reading between the lines, you know what I'm talking about. I kind of wish that the whole thing would just kind of cruise on out to sea and just kind of stay there. If you're reading between the lines. They paint themselves as rubies, but it's crystal clear that, let's see, making this up off the top of my head, that they should have been carted off a long time ago. I'm even tired of feeling the burn of this election process. I mean, the hilariousness of it has just kind of worn off. In all seriousness, the reality is that despite all of the promises that they make to us, the reality is they cannot fulfill our deepest longings and desires. In fact, I just want to look at the TV sometimes and just say, stop the noise. Just stop the noise. And I think sometimes God looks down and says to each of us, stop the noise. Turn with me to the book of Habakkuk. Now I heard a collective, now where is that? Many pages in the Bible have been torn trying to find Habakkuk. Some of y'all are glad for electronic devices. You just press it. Habakkuk, Old Testament book, very short, just two or three chapters. I want to draw your attention to the second one, to the second chapter of Habakkuk. Stop the noise. And I'm going to be reading from the 18th, 19th, and 20th verses in the New International Version, Habakkuk chapter 2. If you have it, let me hear you say, stop the noise. And the word of God says through Habakkuk, of what value is an idol carved by a craftsman? Or an image that teaches lies? For the one who makes it trusts in his own creation. He makes idols that cannot speak. Woe to him who says to wood, come to life, or to lifeless stone, wake up. Can it give guidance? It is covered with gold and silver, yes, but there is no breath in it. And where we are going to spend most of our sermonic time and attention this morning, but the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him. Our theme this morning is stop the noise. Will you pray with me? Father, you have already anointed this moment. You were here before we were born, and you ordained it for our benefit. You set it aside among all the seconds, minutes, and hours. You set aside this one for your name to be magnified before these people. And oh God, somehow in your sovereignty, you chose this man to be your servant. And so I simply trust you in that decision. And I ask that you fulfill your will this morning. May your people see you today. In Jesus' name, amen. The book of Habakkuk, it's one of those obscure Old Testament books. The nation of Israel had already, sometime before, been decimated by the Assyrian Empire. The 10 northern tribes, the tribes of Israel, had already been decimated by the Assyrian Empire. You see, it was their character. It had come over time that they would simply refuse to follow God, and they chose instead to follow the idols that they made with their hands. And so God allowed them to be totally decimated and and annihilated at the hand of the Assyrian Empire. However, the southern tribes, the two southern tribes of Judah and Benjamin, commonly known as Judah, weren't quite as bad as those northern tribes. But nevertheless, having witnessed the experience of their cousins to the north, they found themselves following the same idolatrous trajectory. And they too were on the brink of destruction. Young Nebuchadnezzar was on the rise in the Babylonian Empire, and it was God's design that he would send the Babylonians into Jerusalem, into Judah, to conquer Judah and to take them captive, decimating their city, destroying their temple. And it is against this backdrop that God sends a trio of minor prophets and one major prophet to warn the people of Judah of their persistent idolatry and the impending conflict. He sends Zephaniah, Nahum, and Habakkuk, Jeremiah being the major prophet. Shortly before the Babylonian captivity, these four prophets come as the representative of God to warn the nation of Judah, hey, listen. Look at what you're doing. This is what's getting ready to happen. And so we see in Habakkuk, the second chapter, God gets straight to the point. You have crafted of your own hands idols that you worship, carved wood, speechless. Carved stone, speechless, yet you have trusted in these idols. You have asked them to do of things that they cannot do for you. And you have abandoned me, I who have done so much for you, who have done everything for you. You've looked at it in the face and said, I would rather worship my. And so God sends the message of warning to the land of Judah. And it appears, looking at our life today, looking at our experience today, that the message and the warning reaches down through the centuries, past the generations, and finds itself alive in our time. We look through our experiences and we find ourselves in a very subtle, millennial, new age sort of way, finding ourselves creating idols that we somehow trust more than we trust God. We find ourselves constructing ideas and ways of thinking and ways of engaging with life and ways of looking at life and ways of understanding that somehow we put our trust in, only to discover that they are a bitter failure and disappointment when it comes to fulfilling our most earnest need and our most earnest desire. Some of us find ourselves, I've been here, I'm preaching from my own personal experience. Some of us find ourselves languishing in particular sins, and we return to it over and over and over and over again, hoping that somehow it will bring me a pleasure, that it will bring me a fulfillment, that it will bring me some sort of satisfaction that I am looking for, and time again, I am left decimated with the reality that it cannot do what it was never designed to do. But it is an idol in my life. We find ourselves thinking about God, saying to him, justifying, rationalizing the notion that somehow God just doesn't quite understand my situation. We justify our behavior. We justify our sins. We justify our activities, citing that God just doesn't quite get it, that he can't really identify truly with what is going on in my life. It doesn't seem like he hears me. I call out to him, he doesn't answer. I ask him, I don't hear anything. I don't think that God is there, and we begin to embrace the notion, and we begin to live under a false reality that somehow God isn't there. We go through life calling ourselves Christians. I'm talking about me. Calling ourselves Christians, yet we embrace and embark upon major decisions in our life, and we refuse to acknowledge the presence or counsel of God in any of our major decisions. We enter into relationships, but we take no thought of asking the Holy Spirit's guidance into that relationship. God, is this for me? Have you chosen this for me? Is this what you want me to do? We pursue courses of action in our experiences. We pursue jobs, and we say, it looks good to me. I think I'll take it. Never once pausing for a moment and asking God to illuminate our decision-making process. We go through life making decisions. We pursue degrees, never asking God for one moment, God, is this the direction that you have called for my life? Refusing to ask him to illuminate our path. This is idolatry. Putting trust and confidence in my own thinking without acknowledging God and asking him to direct my path. And we find the reality of the experience is when we do it, utter failure. Even if there is a measure of success in this world, we find that the success fails to fulfill. You take that job, you got that job, you pursued it on your own, you got it, you've reached a measure of financial success, but there's still an emptiness inside. You pursued that relationship, you got that guy, oh, you got that girl, and the relationship seems to be flourishing, yet there is something on the inside that is still hollow. We go through life as Christians and somehow believe that we can be true, authentic, growing Christians and never open the Word of God. Creating a false construct in our mind, suggesting that it really isn't necessary. Or maybe it doesn't speak to my situation. These are idolatrous thoughts. Thoughts that we have somehow bought into and believe that somehow life will be better if we live life according to this ideal. But we find ourselves, our experience, our lives, woefully confused. Like a ship without a rudder, we move from situation to situation, circumstance to circumstance, never being guided by the Word of God. We're wondering why we aren't growing spiritually. Looking at my life is the same way as it was 10 years ago. I'm not any further along spiritually today than I was 20 years ago. You have been starving yourself from the bread of life. This too is idolatry. Something is more important than God's word. We somehow embrace the notion that my sins have irretrievably separated me from God, and that there is no forgiveness for me. We We embrace an idea spiritually that somehow God won't forgive me, hasn't forgiven me, and this causes us to view God from a perspective where we resign ourselves to our sinfulness. And we become satisfied with it. This is as good as it's going to get. This too is idolatry. It is anti-God. And I believe that the Word of God is saying something to us today. Once we come to a realization, we come to the insight that we have chosen ideas and mindsets and mentalities and constructs made with our own hands, with our own thoughts, with our own ideas. When we come to the realization that all of these are hollow and empty and they're silent, they have nothing to say to my situation, and they fail miserably at fulfilling my greatest heart desires, I believe the word of the Lord comes to us and says, the Lord is in his holy temple. Stop the noise. The Lord is in his holy temple. Be still and know that I am God. The Lord is in his holy temple. Sit yourself down and shut yourself up. In the midst of me pursuing all of what I think is good and right, God comes to me and declares, in the midst of my failure, in the midst of my inadequacy, in the midst of my discontentment, he comes to me and he says, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be quiet. But to truly grasp this, you got to understand something about the Lord. For this to be meaningful to you, Keo, you got to come to some understanding and clarity on the Lord. You see, this is not just any title for the supreme being. Let's get a little bit deep here to understand what it means by the Lord is in his holy temple, and how does it address my idolatry? You see, if you're looking in your Bible, whether it's printed or you're looking at it electronically, your L-O-R-D is probably in all caps. If it's in all caps, let me hear you say all caps. Yeah, it's in all caps, because a particular Hebrew word is used there to articulate the name of God. You see, God has many names in the Old Testament. You know, there's Elohim. There's Elohim. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. But that title is normally used in referring to God's mighty, omnipotent power. It has more to do with what God is able to do. And we receive that this morning. We receive what God is able to do. But that's not the word that's used here. You know, there's Adonai. Adonai is another title. You know, this you'll see this one as Lord in the Old Testament, but it's capital L, lowercase O-R-D. And this refers to God's relationship to me. He is the master. He is the Adonai. He is the Lord. I am the servant. But that's not the one that's used here. It's valuable to me, but it's not the one that's used here. The one used here is the Hebrew word Yahweh. See, Yahweh means something a little bit different. See, Elohim refers to the omnipotence of God, but Yahweh refers to the pluripotence of God. I like that word, man, the pluripotence of God. Some of you scientists out there know what pluripotence means. It you know, in the human body, you know, stem cell research is all about capturing these embryonic cells. And the reason they want these cells is because these cells are referred to as pluripotent cells. They are the embryonic cells that can develop into any other kind of cell in the body. You need a liver cell? Find you a pluripotent stem cell and you can grow a liver. You need some spleen cells? Find you a pluripotent stem cell and you can grow some spleen cells. You need some brain tissue? Find you a pluripotent stem cell and you can grow some brain tissue. Yahweh refers to the pluripotence of God. He can be whatever you need for him to be, whenever you need for him to be it. It's not about so much what God can do, but it's about what God can be. God is everything you need for him to be. The Lord, Yahweh, is in his holy temple. The one who can fulfill all of your needs and desires. See, God carried this idea to Moses, Chad. When Moses comes to God at the burning bush and he's standing there, God tells him, hey, listen, take your shoes off, man. You're on holy ground. You're on holy ground. I want you to go and I want you to deliver the children of Israel. And Moses says, well, who shall I tell them is sending me? And God says to him, tell him I am that I am sent you. I will be whatever I need to be. See, Moses, you're concerned and you're worried about if I'm going to provide for you enough to deliver all of these children. Guess what? I can be whatever I need to be. Moses, you're worried about being cold in the desert at nighttime. I will be the flame of fire guiding you by the nighttime. You worried about the heat of the desert day? I'll be the cloud shading you in the noontime hour. You're worried about how you're gonna feed these people? I guarantee you, I will be the manna from heaven. You're worried about if they're gonna be thirsty? Moses, I'm the rock in a weary land. God will be for you everything he needs to be for you. Now notice I didn't say he'll be everything you want him to be for you. He'll be everything that he needs to be for you. God knows what you need. The problem with idolatry is the idea that we think we know what we need. God steps in and says, my friend, have a seat. Stop the noise. My name is Yahweh. I know what you need. I will be everything that you need. The Lord is in his holy temple. But it doesn't end there. Keo, you've got to understand something about the holy temple. See, we got Yahweh down. Now you've got to understand something about the holy temple. Because see, it is significant that Yahweh is in his holy temple. If the antidote, if the answer for my idolatry, for my ideas, for my notions that I can go outside of myself and find or look within me to find everything that I need, if the answer for that is that God, Yahweh, is in his holy temple, the first solution is that God is everything. But the second thing is to understand something about his holy temple. Because if the pluripotent Yahweh is in his holy temple, and it sounds like he must be doing something. But not only doing something, he must be something in his holy temple that's meaningful to me. So come and go with me to the sanctuary. I believe I heard the songwriter say, come and go with me to my Father's house. That ought to make you excited, in fact, because I believe I heard the psalmist say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We come to the temple. You know, the temple has three compartments. It's got that outer court, not covered. We've got that holy place, that middle area. And then we've got that third place, that most holy place where the Shekinah dwells. And as I look in the temple, I'm looking for Yahweh because the word says that Yahweh is in his holy temple. You know, the kids like to play Where's Waldo? Well, we're going to play Where's Yahweh this morning. We're going to look in the holy temple and see where is Yahweh. And I'm looking, and I'm on the east side of the sanctuary. And there I see the altar of burnt offering. And I believe I see a lamb that's slain on the altar as a sacrifice for sin. I believe I can see Yahweh. I believe there Yahweh is. My word says that Jesus Christ is the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Well, you might be asking, what does that have to do with my situation? Some of you who are trapped by sin, some of you who return to your sin time and time again, here's what I had to do. I had to realize and reconcile a fundamental reality, and that was that Jesus Christ has paid the penalty for my sin. And so I didn't have to be laden with guilt anymore. I didn't have to be burdened with the guilt of sin anymore. Why? Because Yahweh is on the altar. The Lord is in his holy temple. So I could sit down and I could be quiet and I could just let the lamb be the sacrifice for my sin. That changed my attitude about that sin, because I suddenly realized, if the God of heaven is willing to die for my sin, why am I so attracted to that thing? If the God of heaven is willing to give his life for me while I'm sinning, oh man, I think I want to let that thing go, and I want to get with that lamb that's on the altar. Taking the reality into your mind that Yahweh is in his holy temple as a sacrifice for your sin while you are sinning will change your mind about continuing to sin. The Lord is in his holy temple. We move on a little bit further to the west, and we're getting ready to go into the door of the holy place. But before we go in, the priest has collected the blood from the lamb, and he's got it in a bowl. And he's walking. He's confessed the sins of the people on the head of the lamb. He's slain the lamb. He's collected it in a bowl. This bowl of blood represents the sins of the people. The blood of Christ shed for the sins of the people. And there he is. He's carrying it. He's walking it. He's got his robe on. And I can imagine the blood is just sloshing back and forth. Some of it spills out onto the side, spills out onto the hands of the priest. And there, the priest is getting ready to go into the holy place, getting ready to minister an atonement, but he's got blood on his hands. The priest has got blood on his hands. I'm glad the priest has got blood on his hands. I'm glad the priest has got my blood on his hands. He's got my sins on his hands. But it's not his blood on his hands. You see, the priest hadn't done anything wrong. You see, that blood represents the wrong that I have done, and he took it, and it's gotten on his hands. And so before he goes into the holy place, there is this big basin with cleansing water in it. And he takes it, and he washes his hands, signifying the righteousness of the priest who is ministering the blood. The Lord is in his holy temple. I believe I see Yahweh once again in the holy temple right there, ministering his righteousness on my behalf. Counting not my sin against me, but counting to me his righteousness. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let me tell you something. Those who might be battling with the idea that God doesn't identify with your situation, you ought to understand that there is a high priest who who is touched with the feelings of your infirmities, yet he is touched without sin. He understands what you're going through. He understands your life circumstance. He understands what place you were born in. He understands the genes that you got. He understands the tendencies that you have. He knows what you are going through, yet he is a righteous mediator of the sacrifice. You've got somebody in the temple who knows exactly what you're going through. And here, the priest moves into the holy place. Now, it's covered. It's covered. And so it's a dark place. All except for he looks to the south. You know, he's moving west. He looks to the south, and there is a candlestick. And it's got seven branches. And it's lit. It's got olive oil feeding it. And this candlestick burns 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Always there, shedding light onto the situation, shedding light into the sanctuary. I believe I see Yahweh in his holy temple again. I believe I see a God who is always ready to give light to your situation, always ready to shed light on your circumstance. Always ready to give you insight as to what you need to do next. There is no need to go through life blind. There is no need to jump from relationship to relationship to relationship to relationship. No need to jump from job to job to job to job. Listen, I learned it the hard way. So I'm here telling you so you don't have to do it anymore. There is a God. There is a Yahweh who is in his holy temple ready to shed light on your situation. Take some time and just pray and ask him. I'm going to drop that one more time. I'm going to drop it one more time just for you. There is a God who is ready to shed light onto your situation. You don't have to traverse this life in darkness. Take some moment each and every day. Before you get out of the bed and say, God, here I am. I don't know what today holds. I don't know what I'm supposed to do today. I don't know what email is going to come across my desk. You know that relationship I'm in? I got questions about it. You know that job I've got? I've been feeling like you're telling me to leave it, or you maybe be telling me not to take it, or whatever it is, talk to God and ask him to show you. Listen, that is not a labor-intensive activity. It doesn't require a whole lot of effort, but what it does require is for you to give up the notion that you know more than God. Humble ourselves and ask him. The promise is that he is ready to shed light on your situation because Yahweh is in his holy temple. He turns to his right and he looks to the north, and there he sees the bread. You know the light is shedding, illuminating the bread. You see the light over here helps the priest to see the bread. It's 12 loaves there. The light over here sheds light and illuminates the bread. The Lord is in his holy temple. I believe I heard the word say that Jesus is the bread of life. I believe I heard the word say, take this and eat it. This is my body, which is broken for you. Listen, my friends, you cannot go through this life and not intake the word of God. Listen, you can't do it. If your life is looking scattered and aimless right now, There was a little song we used to sing in Sabbath school. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. Neglect your Bible, forget to pray, and you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. There's a lot of gospel in that song right there. You must dispense with the notion that somehow you will be guided by your own ideas. You must dispense with the notion that somehow you can change your own life by simply thinking good thoughts. You don't know what good is. I don't know what good is. It is the bread, the word that shows me what is good. And as I partake of it, I become strong spiritually. Have you ever had that experience where some little thing happened in your life and it knocked you off your feet? That's because you have no faith. And you have no faith because you haven't been in the Word. The Word says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Listen, listening to us once a week is not enough bread. It's not enough bread. You must partake of the Word of God daily. The reason the bread was there every day, all day, 7 days a week, in the Jewish calendar, 360 days a year, they traded it out, new loaves every week, new loaves every week, always fresh bread there. Why? As a message to you and me, Yahweh is in his holy temple. He is the bread of life. Take him in through the word. You must. People, Riverside, you must. You must. The word of God, I'm going to say this one more thing about the word. The word of God is what the Holy Spirit uses to transform your life. The transformation that you will experience as a Christian does not come in the absence of Bible study. For Rashida, one more time. You cannot grow in your Christian experience without the word. Let me show you two ditches. There are people who pray a lot and don't study. They tend to be superstitious Christians. They don't know what to pray for. They pray for all kinds of stuff. Their prayers are scattered and all over the place. You have got to combine your prayers with the word of God. You, give you an example. You're wondering about a job or a relationship or a decision that you need to make. And you're trying to figure out, what do I pray? I'll give you a text. You need a Bible text. You gotta pray a text. You say to yourself, Proverbs 3, 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct thy paths. God, I don't know what to do about this job, but you said in your word that if I acknowledge you, you would direct my paths. I don't know what you're gonna do. I don't even need to see what you're gonna do. I'm just trusting that you're gonna direct my path. Suddenly, your stress level. Why? Because you prayed with the word. But you don't know what to pray if you never get any word in. You don't know how to trust God with no word. People who study the word a lot but don't pray are in the other ditch. They are legalistic know-it-alls who are experiencing no spiritual growth because they never talk to the one who applies the word to their life. They never ask the Holy Spirit, what does this mean? I see it, but what does it mean? The candle sheds light on the bread. It helps me to understand what the word is saying. You ever hear people who, they don't exegete things, they eisegete things. Exegesis is a proper interpretation of the scripture. Eisegesis is just what I think it says. Those are people who study but don't pray. Read your Bible, pray every day. It will prevent you from creating idolatrous thoughts in your mind. He's moving west. There's an altar. There's incense on it. It's burning. It's a sweet-smelling savor. He's got the bowl. He's taking and he is flicking the blood onto the veil that's separating the holy place from the most holy place. He's putting my sin in the holy place. And there it stays all day, every day. There's the veil, dried blood, day after day, after day, after day. It's a stinky place. It's a pretty foul place. There, in the holy place, is my sin. And there's the altar of incense, providing a sweet smell to cover the stench of my sin. Some of you have been going through life thinking that you somehow are trapped by your sin. Somehow wondering how God is ever going to come to you because you've got so much sin. And it makes you begin to turn your back on God and distrust him. But Yahweh is in his holy temple because the incense represents the sweet smelling savor of the righteousness of Jesus Christ that covers your sin. Oh, this is a beautiful thing. Here God chooses to dwell in a sanctuary full of your sin. How is it that a holy and righteous God can dwell in a sanctuary full of sin? Because he doesn't see your sin. He's not smelling your sin. He's smelling the righteous life of Jesus Christ. You've got to believe that. Yahweh is in his holy temple. This keeps you from idolatrous thoughts. And once a year, miraculously, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest would take the blood and take it behind the veil. And he would minister. He's got the sins of the whole nation right here. And he's before the mercy seat, and there the very presence of God is dwelling. And he sprinkles the blood before the mercy seat. The high priest has bells on the bottom of his robe. One bell, one pomegranate. One bell, one pomegranate. And he's got a rope that's tied around one ankle that leads all the way to the outside into the camp. So that if so happened to be that the high priest found himself defiled as he was ministering before the holy place, see the children of Israel would be listening for the bells. Are the bells still ringing? Is the high priest still ministering? Is God still taking care of my sin? I think I still hear bells. Yahweh is in his holy temple. Should they ever hear the bells cease, they would know that the high priest has died, and they would pull the rope, pulling his body out. But the testimony of scripture is that it never happened. Jesus is a righteous high priest, able to minister. And when God accepted the sacrifice on the Day of Atonement, the entire sanctuary was miraculously cleansed. The veil was cleansed. The horns on the altar was cleansed. All the blood that had dripped on the ground from day to day cleansed. You ought to recognize something, that God is doing an atonement work in the world today. You're worried and looking in your life and you're saying, when am I going to overcome that thing? When am I going to get a victory over that thing? When is that thing going to be taken away from me? When am I going to conquer sin in my life? Well, I've got news for you today. The first thing that you've got to begin to embrace is that Jesus has already paid the price for your sin. He did that on the altar. You've got to believe something else, that the sweet incense of the righteousness of Jesus Christ stands as your substitute. You never can be righteous enough for God to accept you. He accepts you just because he likes you. And finally, oh my friends, God is doing an atoning work in your life. He is working out your sanctification. How does that look? When you hear a voice behind you and it says, this is the way, walk ye in it. Walk in it. Walk in it. When you hear the Holy Spirit say, go that way, then just go. Just go. That is working out your salvation with fear and trembling. But it's the most difficult thing in the world to do. You know it is, right? You've experienced that. It's the most difficult thing in the world to do. Why? Because it demands that we release control over our idolatrous thoughts that say, I know better than God. God is atoning now. He is purifying your life so that your life can be a reflection. You're battling with sex and money? The Lord is in his holy temple. Stop moving. Stop trying to do it your way. Stop trying to rustle and squiggle your way out of it. The Lord is in his holy temple. He is the pluripotent God who is everything that you need for a life of victory in this life. And so, to the nation of Israel, Habakkuk says, stop looking to wood and stone. Stop shouting to them, asking them to do things for you that they cannot do. Instead, recognize that the I am, the pluripotent God, is in his holy temple.